If you accept my words and store up my commands within you, turning your ear to wisdom and applying your heart to understanding, indeed, if you call out for insight and cry aloud for understanding, and if you look for it as for silver and search for it as for hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. For the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. Proverbs 2, 1 through 6. This passage is one that draws my attention. As students in college, we're existing in a stage of life where we truly are beginning to seek knowledge and wisdom in ways that we've never been dedicated to before. We are out on our own taking classes and accumulating wisdom from experiences and people on how we should move forward to correctly and successfully live life. I know that I cannot be the only one who has found this to be a massive undertaking. The further that I've found myself digging, the harder the questions get about morality, faith, and flourishing. So how do we go about this thing called life, and how do we live it well? Tonight, we're fortunate enough to have the Wisely family, Collegiate Professor of Philosophy and Director of the Notre Dame Institute of Advanced Study, Dr. Megan Sullivan, here to help direct our thoughts on a good life. Sullivan teaches courses at all levels and founded Notre Dame's God and the Good Life program. This program introduces undergraduates to big philosophical questions concerning happiness, morality, and meaning, and key methods for wrestling with them. Sullivan's research tends to focus on philosophical problems concerning time, modality, rational planning, value theory, and religious belief. She has two books, Time Biases and The Good Life Method, and is in the process of a third. Sullivan has degrees from the University of Virginia, Oxford, and Rutgers. She also serves as an executive committee member at large for the American Philosophical Association. Please join me in welcoming our speaker, Dr. Megan Sullivan.
Thank you. You passed your first test. Actually, the first test was getting these slides to work. That required a PhD today. Thank you for the very kind introduction. This is the first time I've ever been out to Barry. True story, I'm from Greensboro, North Carolina originally, and when I was getting ready to go to college, my dad wanted more than anything for me to go to the University of Georgia. It was the only college visit he took me on. He took me three times. He took me on to one college for a visit three times. It's a 6-hour drive from Greensboro to Athens, and he was just in love with the state of Georgia and the idea of going to the University of Georgia. And he barely forgave me when I went north to the University of Virginia instead. But I love being down here, and it's been so wonderful the last 2 days to get to know the Barry community and to get to spend time with students and with your faculty and to just see how intentional this community is. I'll also be honest, I'm mildly shocked that there are so many of you here on a Monday night for a philosophy talk. Maybe there's some extra credit situation maybe or something going on, But I find it deeply moving as a philosopher and as a professor that in an era when we have Netflix and when we have very busy, high-pressure lives, that you guys would take some time out of this busy season to think about a big philosophical question and to think about the good life, and not just to listen to me bloviate about it, but to actually be here in community to talk with each other about it. And if there's anything that philosophy can do for us or that I hope to give to you with our time together tonight, it's some questions and perspectives and ideas that then you're going to take out into the world, out into your later conversations here at Barry to keep ruminating on and chewing on, and it'll hopefully start to grow. As Olivia mentioned in her introduction, I teach a really big philosophy class at Notre Dame called God and the Good Life, which tries in 14 weeks to answer the question about what the meaning of each of our individual lives are, and I think it does a pretty effective job. Just in case you can't come to Notre Dame to take the class, we wrote a book trying to explain in 200 easy pages at your local Barnes & Noble the meaning of every human life, including yours. This is what I did during the pandemic. And tonight I'm here to give you, I guess, a little bit of a preview of that. That's not what's going to happen tonight. What's going to happen tonight, when I was talking to your chaplain, John, he mentioned that he thought a topic that the Barry community would be really interested in for a philosophy lecture is the idea of how faith sits with the good life. And as I was thinking about it, I write a little bit about it in the book, and I talk a lot about William James in my class, this great philosopher who teaches about faith and the good life. But working on this talk for you guys, I realized that there are some questions that I have as a philosopher about faith and the good life that I've not really had a chance to work out for myself yet. Something that bothers me about a way a lot of philosophers typically talk about what faith is that I don't think exactly gets to the heart of what we're after. And so preparing for this talk, I decided to do something a little bit new for you guys. This is the first time I've ever given this lecture. And it's basically looking at how faith sits with the good life and some questions and ideas that I've been sitting with for a while now, and I'd like for other people to talk about it with me. So I'm gonna kind of share my half-baked idea of faith and the good life with you guys for the next 35, 40 minutes, and also in the process maybe give you a sense about how philosophers reason about these questions and where the debate is. And then there is going to be an opportunity for you guys to ask some questions to me and to pose maybe questions for the group. And there'll be some directions about how to do that once I finish talking. Technology is involved and it's way above my pay grade. So, I don't know, sound fun? If not, just quietly get up and leave. I won't blame you. So our topic is faith in the good life, and the subtitle, this is what I insisted on, is becoming the kind of people who are worthy of our greatest ambitions. And I hope by the end of the talk, we're at least understanding a little bit about what philosophers mean when they talk about having ambitions. To get us going, at least in philosophical contexts, when we talk about what faith is, usually the debate centers around faith as being something you do when you don't know something. So faith is the opposite of having knowledge. It's maybe hoping that something will be true, or hoping that something will be happening when you're uncertain that it's true or uncertain that it's going to happen. So, I don't know, do we have any Eagles fans in the audience? Yeah, that's actually surprising for where we are. So Eagles fans have faith that this year the Eagles are going to win the Super Bowl. They don't know it's going to happen unless they're like have some secret plan to poison the enemy or whatever. Nobody knows the outcome of a future contingent event like the Super Bowl, but being an Eagles fan means that no matter what, you hope it's true that the Eagles are going to win. That's what it is to have faith in the Eagles. Or maybe you get a scary diagnosis from your doctor, and you don't know if you're going to survive this round of cancer, but you have faith that you'll survive because having that kind of hope that you're going to make it, that you're going to be in that positive end of the percentage, is one of the things that sustains you, that keeps you going. And if you didn't believe that, then you wouldn't be willing to go through all of the difficulties of treatment. Or maybe you have faith that God exists, and you don't know for certain, you don't think anybody could know for certain, but you think like holding that as something that you believe makes a lot of other things make sense. So we oftentimes define faith as an attitude that you have when you're missing knowledge. There's like a lack of knowledge. And philosophers then are off to the races debating ever since Blaise Pascal what could possibly be reasonable about believing something but not having evidence. And if you've ever taken a philosophy of religion class, you've probably heard these debates play out. The kind of big questions philosophers tend to spend all their time on is it reasonable for you to believe that the Eagles will win knowing that there's at best a 50-50 chance of that happening? Or is it reasonable for anybody to believe that an omnipotent, morally perfect being exists without having sufficient evidence or realizing that we live in a world that's got a lot of suffering in it? That's one question philosophers spend a lot of time on. Another one is just when it's good to not be rational. Let's suppose you think faith is not a reasonable attitude. Is it sometimes good to do things that are not reasonable? When I've taught about faith in the good life, I've often spent all my time on these questions. We might, in philosophy, call them epistemic questions, questions about our knowledge and rationality. And I'm actually starting to think that we're missing the point. Like, we're not talking about some of the much more interesting questions about faith in the good life when we spend all of our time on this. So what I would like for us to think about tonight is a different definition of faith, and one that if you're a Christian, you're going to think maybe this is like super obvious and you don't understand why they had to pay me to explain it to you. But I think it's a definition of faith that seems common in a lot of religious traditions, especially in Christianity, but is not taken seriously enough as a philosophical idea about the good life. And I want to argue that regardless of your religious commitments, this kind of faith can play an important role in your good life, and that this should be an important area in which we debate each other about what we're hoping for or aiming for in life. And you'll see what I mean in just a second. So first, I got to introduce you to one philosopher. There's not going to be, I'm going to dump a lot of philosophers at you at the end of this talk, but the one that you want to keep your eye on for the beginning of this talk is Aristotle. Aristotle is the big good life philosopher, at least in the Western world. Probably Confucius is the big good life philosopher in the Eastern tradition, but Aristotle's a big guy in the Western tradition. Aristotle, his teacher was Plato. He's getting going in Athens and the surrounding region in about 400 BC, so about 2400 years ago. He founds this school called the Lyceum, and he teaches this really important class about the good life to his students. And what he says he's going to teach his students is not only how to go about becoming happier people, he thinks that's an important subject and he's got something to say about it, but also he says he's going to help his students get a clearer view about what their goal is when they claim they want to be happier. And his work on these questions about the goals and means to become a happier person kind of sets the stage for what comes in a lot of later philosophy. So one of the key insights from Aristotle is that we're all, by our very nature, goal-driven creatures. We all have things that we are striving for ourselves. This is a picture of me, the one and probably only time in my life I've ever been on the Jumbotron at the Notre Dame Stadium. I won a teaching award, and as a result, I got to do the thing that is the ultimate sign of honor at the University of Notre Dame. I got to walk out in the field at one of the breaks in the second quarter, and for 30 seconds stand on the football field, receive a football, wave to the audience, and then quickly be shuffled out of the way. And this was amazing. I'd wanted this. I'd seen other people get this award, and I was like, oh my gosh, I can't wait to one day I'm the one that's out on the field waving to everybody. This is the pinnacle of human existence. I'd strive for it. It represents a great deal of virtue for me, like being a great teacher, being really funny, being beloved of my colleagues and students. This is a goal that I was really hoping for, and you know, only an arrogant person says before they get the award that they really wanted it, but I really wanted it. And then I got it, and I felt really great. Aristotle's first like genius insight is we all have stuff like this that we want, and if we got it, we think we'd feel really great, and that would be the good life for us. Aristotle has a term for this like general state of getting the things that we want that we feel like are going to be big accomplishments for a creature like us, and he calls it eudaimonia. This is his idea of happiness. It's like the state of flourishing and accomplishment that you work for over the course of your life, and if you're very fortunate, you become the kind of person who has those accomplishments. Aristotle also, and this is where it gets weird, thought that really, everything in the universe has like a way it's striving to be, or a kind of goal or an essence. There's like an ideal version of being a rock. There's an ideal version of being a person who's achieved eudaimonia. There's an ideal version of any kind of artifact, like an iPhone. And there are also, to put it technically, crappy versions of things. There are crappy versions of humanity. There are cracked, broken iPhones. There are rocks, Aristotle thought, that stink at being rocks. They don't fall in the right way. They're not hard enough. And when we worry about having a good life, or when we worry about eudaimonia, what we're worried about is we don't have the right features for being a good version of what it is to be a human, according to Aristotle. All right, that's all you need to know about Aristotle today. Oh, one more thing you need to know about Aristotle. This is my colleague Jeff hitting a target when we went axe throwing over Christmas. Aristotle thought that one of the things philosophy can do for us is help us get clearer about our goal so that we can be smarter about how to hit it. So if we claim that we've got these goals for ourselves, this idea of eudaimonia, this idea of like, you know, I really want to be on the stadium waving to the crowd, got these things that we're striving for, it can be really frustrating if you pick the wrong goal and you spend all your time going after it. It can also be really frustrating if your goal is just like really hazy and you're never quite sure what it is. When we talk about living a good life, that can feel like a really hazy goal that needs to be made more serious. And Aristotle thought philosophy is really good at helping us pick our target. All right, now you need to know all the Aristotle that you need to know to have this debate with me tonight. So I want to start off by giving you an activity. If you were my students, I'd say take out your pen and paper right now, but you're not. So I'm just going to ask you to hold this in your mind for the talk. How many of you guys have heard of a big, hairy, audacious goal? This is like a business school thing. Yeah, exactly. If you go through management training. Big, hairy, audacious goal something that you can have for your group or your company, but you can also have it for your own life. I want you guys to think for a minute, and you don't have to share it right now, but just think for a minute, close your eyes if it helps. What is one goal that you have? You think, if this happened to me some point in the future, I would have the good life. This would be so amazing. Just put it up in your head. Like for me, it might be like winning the teaching award and getting to go on the football stadium, getting the Nobel Prize for philosophy. Maybe it's like having kids or getting married someday. Maybe it's something super evil, like accumulating $1 billion and destroying your enemies. It's okay. I want you to be honest with yourself. Put that goal in your mind and hold it. Does anybody need more time? Anybody not a teleological creature? All right. So we all have these goals. Aristotle, you just did what Aristotle said. Here is one philosophical problem. This is a very serious philosophical problem I would like you guys to now entertain. We form goals. We're teleological creatures. And sometimes our goals turn out to be lame. Let me give you some examples, hypothetical examples, not hypothetical at all, examples from my own life. First, I have always been a goal-driven creature, and from ages 8 to 14, I had exactly one BHAG, one big, hairy, audacious goal, and that was to accumulate enough money to buy all of the Legos, and then to have my own house where they could be in all the rooms, and I could play with them as long as I wanted. I remember if you looked at like pictures I would draw in fourth grade, it was all about my future Lego house, and this room has all the pirate sets, and this room has all the city sets, and I could buy anyone frictionlessly that I ever wanted, and I'd be never told to put them away, and that was how I'd spend my entire life. I am kind of glad that that goal was never granted, because as much as I think that eudaimonia consists of frictionless Lego acquisition, that was actually setting my sights a little bit low for what a good life could be. Sometimes our goals are lame because we're mistaken about ourselves. And that was an issue. I was just like barely formed as a young person, so couldn't dream of a life better than Legos. But then you get older and you think, I know myself, and I know that I am meant to be a lawyer. As a teenager and an early college student, I watched the Pelican Brief and watched, you know, A Few Good Men and did high school debate and thought, in my heart of hearts, I'm a killer. I love to use power of logic and persuasion to win, and I am meant to run a major law firm, and I'm going to make money and have an incredible family, and the vehicle to eudaimonia for me is going to be this career in law. And that's like much more thought out than the Lego dream I have as a child. But it turns out to be lame in another way. Like, I really didn't know who I was when I was 16 years old. I had this vision of myself and this vision of what my future self as a lawyer would be. But really, I had a lot of growing up to do. And by the time I got to college, I realized that there were many traits, many virtues that make somebody a great lawyer that I didn't have. And in fact, much more pushed me towards a life as a philosopher. And I'm very glad that I didn't have to like irrevocably decide to be a lawyer when I was 19 years old, because then now I'd be 40 and be just a really unhappy lawyer, a lawyer that was pretty far from eudaimonia. So first philosophical problem facing the good life is that we are goal-seeking creatures, and we're also smart enough, unlike other animals, to realize that some of our goals are better than other goals, and a lot of times we pick dumb goals. Animals don't realize this. Aristotle points this out. Like, you know, your dog has a goal. Get the treats. Get outside. Get the pets. And it's very goal-driven. If you've ever seen a dog just go crazy to get some food or to get your attention, it's a goal-seeking creature. But dog just doesn't have the capacity to reflect about whether the thing it's going after full bore is a good thing. Humans, the thing that makes us special is we have the capacity to wonder about whether our goals are the right ones and to also anticipate a lot of frustration in our goal-seeking activities. Which gets to the next like big question. When people think about faith in the good life, they think if we're talking about how to integrate faith into the good life, we have to focus on the fact that some humans think about these eternal goals. Like they say, well, my goal is not just to be Lego master or to be a powerful lawyer. My goal is to get into the kingdom of God and enjoy the beatific vision forever. And we know people who have these goals. I bet Jonathan has these goals, given that he's a chaplain. But come on, a lot of us, I mean, like, on Christmas and Easter, I think about how excited I am about going to heaven. On a Monday in January, I'm really excited about other things. Like, I'm excited about this life going well. I hope the next one goes really well, but I also want this life to go very well. And if the only thing faith can give me is a kind of virtue that focuses on a life after this one, you might think that it's going to be very hard to convince people who are not already, like, just insanely invested in their religious tradition to care about faith. It's also hard to get motivated by these goals that seem really distant or really far off or really hard to get your mind around what it's going to be like. The best kinds of goals, and this is what Aristotle's talking about when he talks about hitting the target with your axe, the best kind of goals are ones that we have clearly in our mind, like that are right before us, that seem really concrete, visceral goals. And that's why it can be a little bit hard to say you're going to structure your good life around some eternal heavenly goal if you don't really have a concrete, visceral, full feeling about what that goal could be or a sense of who you are as a person that's going after that goal. That's the first maybe controversial thing I'm going to say tonight, but don't worry, there's more. So here's a different definition of faith that I'm going to try to argue for is part of the good life, and it's not just part of the good life because you care about heaven, though it's great if you do, but it's also part of the good life if you care about achieving eudaimonia and flourishing in this life, and that's going to be what I'm going to try to prove in the rest of this talk. Here's the idea, and again, if you're a religious Christian, you probably think this is super obvious, doesn't even deserve its own slide, but just trust me, this is not typically the way philosophers frame this debate. I want to understand faith, the kind of faith that we're wondering how it fits into the good life, as having an awareness of God's presence, either in our interior lives, in our thoughts, and in our minds, and our desires, or out in the world and the way things are moving around us. So faith is this kind of awareness of God. And it's your ability to respond to that awareness with love. Love directed at other people, love directed at God himself, but faith is like you're sensitive to the inputs. If you think of yourself like a computer, which you shouldn't, but if you do, think the first part of this definition of faith is your spidey sense picks up on the God facts in yourself and in the world. The second part is then your output is love. And I want to talk about this as a virtue that you might cultivate and one that we can argue using philosophy is an important part of, can be an important part of having a good life. And if you're missing this virtue, you might struggle. That'll be the more controversial claim also of this talk. So here's the first problem as we start to try to break down this definition of faith. When we become aware that we need to become aware of something, this can be really scary. Because developing awareness as a virtue, and when philosophers use the word virtue, they're not thinking about like Victorian etiquette or like, oh, virtuous, I set the table correctly. When we talk about virtue, we're talking about the personality traits, the features of who you are as a person that enable you to have eudaimonia, that make you a flourishing, happy, great person. So when we think about certain virtues as requiring awareness, this can be really scary because becoming aware often means changing a lot of our other habits. I'll give you an example. I set as my good life goal for the new year being healthier. I think like I really want to be somebody that has these virtuous traits of being stronger, more physically fit, changing my body in certain ways, getting good sleep, just generally having the virtue of health in my life. And I also realized, because I'm a mildly smart person, that if you're going to become healthier, you have to become more aware of how often you exercise and whether you're doing the exercises the right way and whether you're eating the right things. The path to good health is not just a matter of signing up, like, I want to be healthy in 2023. It's a matter of starting to pay a lot more attention to things you do throughout your day and to look at them in different ways, to be like, should I really have that sixth rib at Moe's Barbecue when I'm visiting Barry? Made a bad decision there. So becoming healthy requires cultivating this awareness about how food works, awareness about how your body works, awareness about how exercise works. And then there can be this problem, that awareness, whatever. It sounds really great, but as you cultivate it, then suddenly you start to become aware of temptations and stumbling blocks that you didn't even notice in your vicinity before. Here's a real one from my life right now. I developed this goal to be healthier and then became aware that Dave's Hot Chicken opened up right next door to Notre Dame over Christmas break. And before, I didn't really pay that much attention to this chicken restaurant that was opening. And now that I'm on this diet, I can't stop thinking about the chicken restaurant. I think about it every day. And I go, should I pack my lunch today? Well, maybe today will be the day that I go get chicken tenders for the millionth time. the awareness that goes into cultivating good health, it kind of hurts to have to develop it because I have to start paying attention to all this other stuff that wasn't kind of occupying my mind before. So when we think about faith as a kind of awareness of God, one of the things we shouldn't do is naively think that developing that awareness is going to be super easy or that's going to fit with other kinds of awareness that we've been cultivating over the course of our life or that we're not going to have to go through some difficulties in trying to develop it. So here's the big question that I want to hit now with the second half of this talk. And I'll start doing philosophy in the sense like I'll give you examples to try to prove my points and then I'm going to raise some objections at the end. But here's the big question. How does faith, understood as if you're developing faith, you're developing an awareness of God in your interior life and in the world, and you're agreeing to respond to that awareness with love, how does that fit in to an idea of having a good life in this life? So before you die, before you achieve any kind of afterlife. And how would we try to argue that it would fit into a vision of the good life? The same way I just kind of tacitly gave you an argument that health fits into the good life. It's kind of a goal that it's good for somebody to have. It requires somebody to change their habits, but if they change in the right way, they might transform themselves into a person that's doing better. How could faith possibly be like that? Is it on a par with health? And I want to argue that it is, and that philosophers ought to pay more attention to offering these kinds of arguments. And I think that there are two roles that faith can play in a good life. And again, I think these are roles that we can at least point out to folks who are not religious, even if at the end of the day they don't think that these virtues are necessarily accessible to themselves. And here's the first role. I think faith can play a really great role in helping us prepare for the good things that we want in life but we don't have yet. So I'll give you an example. Here's another obvious fact, perhaps, but one that we don't pay enough attention to, I think, in our ordinary lives or in ethics. Here's a fact. It can be bad, it can be dangerous to get something that you want before you are prepared for it, before you're the kind of person who should have that good thing. Think back for a second to your big, hairy, audacious goal. And pause, and I don't know what you were thinking of when you came up with that. Maybe your goal is to, like, you know, get home in time to watch a zombie show tonight. And that's, that'll be easy. But maybe your goal is something much more ambitious. Like, my goal is to be a brain surgeon. Or my goal is to be a CEO of a Fortune 500 company. I want you to reflect for a second. If that happened to you right now, somebody said, we're putting you in for brain surgery next week, scrub in. Or they said, guess what? You've been elected the new CEO of Twitter. I heard they're looking for one, and it's you. Do you think that from a standpoint of your personal happiness, you have all the things that you need right now for that to be good for you if it happened right away? And maybe the Twitter case is like, you know, any dumbo could run Twitter better than Elon Musk. We're going to get to him in a second. But for a lot of us, I think sometimes we think about these goals and be like, whoa, 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 hold the phone. There's some stuff that, like, I need to get in the tank before I'm ready for this good thing to happen to me. And being goal-driven creatures who are pretty smart about the good life, we oftentimes develop this ability to realize, like, I want that, but I'm not ready for it yet. Here's a simple example from my life. This is a true story. I like to ride bikes, but I'm not very good at riding bikes. I've only started riding them a few years ago. I run into trees a lot. I ran into an unnamed high-level university administrator on my bike one day when I was riding across campus. Luckily, I was going kind of slow, but I was steering so badly. And I think she thought there's no way I could hit her because I'm going so slow, and I surely did. I decided a couple of years ago, I had a pretty good bike. I had a big mountain bike with a big basket and like 12 speeds, but it was a big, just heavy, slow-moving bike. And if you have a good mountain bike, you can get a better bike. And this is a specialized Diverge gravel bike. This is a road bike, a really nice $2,000 French road bike. And I thought, if the mountain bike is good, this is better. This is like Eudaimonia bike. And so I went to the bike store, you know, wore my like, you know, butt pad pants and everything and my cleats and was like, I'm buying the Diverge. And the people at the bike store were like, yes, ma'am. Sold me the bike, helped me put it together, helped me load it onto my car. I get this bike home and it's time to take the test drive around my neighborhood. Guys, I can't ride the bike. The bike is super hard. You got to get like in the crouching road bike position. The tires are so narrow. If you already have steering trouble on a big, heavy mountain bike, this thing is impossible. I fell off a bunch of times just trying to ride it in front of my house. I could never switch the gears. They had disc brakes that just like stopped me. As soon as you touch the brake, it immediately stops. I'd fall off. Not the good life. I should have stuck with my mountain bike. I was completely unprepared to ride this bike. And I did for 2 years. I made myself ride it because I honor sunk costs and made my friends go on bike trips with me where they would just watch me hit things and fall off on this bike. And then I threw out my back and now this beautiful black bike, it sits in the shed locked up in my backyard and is just like a reminder of my failure as a cyclist. If I had been a more rational agent, I would have paused for a second and done a little bit of reflection about whether or not I was ready for a bike this good. And it's okay to want to ride a bike that's as cool as this, and this bike looks way cooler than my actual bike. But it's not the bike for me, and that's because I just have not worked even closely hard enough to be the kind of person who knows what to do with a bike like this. This can happen in a personal context. So let's again take our Elon Musk example. Some of you guys might really want tremendous career success and might want to be somebody's boss someday and to run a big office or a big company and to achieve great things as a result of that work. And here's a question that requires a bit of honesty that some people on planet Earth don't have. It turns out actually a lot of people on planet Earth don't have. 76% of bosses apparently don't have this. The introspection to realize I don't have yet the skills, the virtue, and the empathy to be a great leader for other people. It's something I have to work on. It's not good enough to want that kind of power over other people right now. It's something I've got to transform myself into a better person that's worthy of that kind of position. Otherwise, you're going to end up being, again, 76% of bosses whose employees find them to be just utterly toxic. Not the good life for the people around you to think that you're a bad person. But this also requires thinking, I want this goal, but I've got to change. I've got to become the kind of person who's worthy of that goal. Elon Musk has not done that important soul care yet, but who knows, he could be growing. There's another fact. So there's like wanting a good thing and also realizing that you're not quite ready for it, that you need to develop other virtues, that you need to change and become more aware and become ready to be that kind of person. There's also something that we are aware of that animals really aren't, which is realizing no matter how hard we try and how much we grow, there might be suffering and disappointments that are absolutely outside of our control that are going to disrupt our plans as we search for these goals. And you can't risk-proof your life. There's literally nothing you can do to make sure that your road from here to that big, hairy goal is an easy one. And this is where I think faith can also, or come back into faith, can become really important. I learned so much philosophy from talking with my students, and oftentimes I should probably tell this to them, but well, they'll have a conversation with me in office hours that they think is pretty minor, and I will keep thinking about the conversation for years and reflecting on it. And one student came into my office hours 5 years ago when we had a conversation like this. She was writing a paper. I'd asked all the students to write a paper on the following question: are you going to practice a religion in the future, like in your adult life? And if so, why? Please talk about one philosopher. And if not, why not? Please also talk about one philosopher that we learned in this class. And usually students just write what they think I want to hear, honestly, on this question, or whatever philosopher is easiest for them to find a passage for. I don't know if you guys ever do this, just lie to your professors to try to get the assignment over with. But I appreciated this young woman comes to my office, and she really wanted to answer the question, but she wanted to make sure that the answer was okay. So she comes to my office and she's like, Professor Sullivan, I've been thinking about your question and here's my answer. I'm not going to practice any religion even though I was raised Catholic. She goes to Notre Dame, big surprise. I was raised Catholic. I'm not going to practice any religion for the next 10 years. But then after that, I think I'm going to start practicing a religion again and it'll probably be Catholicism because that's the one that I know. And I was like, okay, that's a new one. So you're going to take a 10-year sabbatical and then you're going to come back. Like, what? Why? Like, why are you going to come back? And she's like, which philosopher should I write about? I was like, I don't know. This is a new one. And I was like, well, tell me a little bit more about your reasoning here. And she's like, here's my reasoning. I know that for the next 10 years, my prediction is life is going to go pretty well. I'm going to get my job. I'm going to get married. I'm going to hang out with my friends. And I'm honestly too busy for this nonsense. Like, I like to sleep in on Sundays. I've got other plans. So I think I'm just going to kind of like put this on the way, way back burner, turn the volume way down on the Catholic stuff while I live my life. I was like, okay, all right. Now, so why do you think you're going to restart? And she says, well, I also know, you know, about 10 years from now, things are going to get hard again. Like somebody in my family will get really sick. Maybe somebody will die. There's going to be some big disappointment. I'm going to lose my job or something bad is going to happen in one of these close relationships. She's like, when that happens, then I'm going to be Catholic again. Like, okay. And she's like, because I'm going to know at that point that the stuff I've been writing about for the first 10 years being my plan is not going to work anymore. I was like, oh, that takes a lot of self-reflection. I think that's actually a pretty wise view of somebody who's thinking about the arc of her whole life. And we talked about it, and I was like, you know, do you think you want any practice before the main event? So you're going to need to be Catholic at, like, some loved one's funeral. Do you want to have practiced at, like, any religious services before the big one so that you're going to know what to do? And she's like, oh, that's an interesting point. Like, before you got to run the spiritual marathon, you might want to have had some practice with, like, low stakes practice. But this gets us back to this definition of faith. And again, I've thought about this conversation quite a bit because I take this woman seriously. She's really introspecting of what kind of person she is and what her goals are for the future. And just thinking the challenge for her view is hoping that that faith is like an awareness and response is going to be ready for the really big event of suffering or the really big challenge when you get thrown a curveball if you haven't cultivated it along the way. So we go back to the exercise metaphor. You might think, I really want to get healthy, but I'm not going to do it right now because Dave's hot chicken and I'm in Georgia and I just can't. I think that's okay, but if I know that about myself and my plans, I know I'm not going to work on developing this kind of awareness and response right now, then if I'm also a reasonable person, I know that I can't sign up to run an ultra marathon next year. Because I also know that I just will not have done the things that are getting me ready to do the big thing. So one area, like thinking about developing faith in our life right now, I think that there's this really interesting question. If you're the kind of person with big goals and you're trying to make them tight and clear the way Aristotle advises us to do, and you're also aware the big challenges are going to come your way. And my student knows this. She doesn't quite know what they're going to be. That's where the uncertainty is. But she knows that they're coming her way. Developing faith right now, developing this kind of awareness of God's presence and his ability to respond might be a crucial part of building yourself into the kind of person that's prepared for those derailing happiness events when they come. And that might be an important way in which faith fits into our good life. And this gets into a little bit the Christian tradition and ways we see Jesus and the disciples and St. Paul and the early church fathers debating about faith. One passage that I really love, we got Jesus talking to his disciples about bad things that are going to come their way. This is a part of the gospel we sometimes like skip over, how many times Jesus spends warning the disciples that this is going to be lame, it's going to be hard. And he tells the disciples, you guys are going to go out and you're going to be preaching the good news and people are going to be awful to you. Some people are going to be horrible to you. And not only that, but when they are horrible to you, you're going to have to forgive them right away, which is going to be a really hard thing to do. It's going to be like kind of running an emotional ultra marathon. Somebody's done something horrible to you. It's done something deeply unjust to you, and you're going to have to just reflexively respond with love and forgive them. That's going to be really challenging. And this is, most of the time, the disciples, I think, are kind of bumbling in these conversations with Jesus. Like, they're always doing slightly the wrong thing. They're acting out of fear. This is one of these key moments where the disciples, I think, have exactly the right response. They hear this from Jesus. Tough things are coming your way, and you're going to have to be like this emotional superhero when they hit you. And the disciples say, please increase our faith. Faith is something that can be increased for the disciples. What do they mean here? They definitely can't mean, Lord, increase our confidence in light of our ignorance. That just doesn't seem to be making sense of how this kind of faith would be equipping the disciples to deal with all the tough stuff that's coming their way. It seems rather what the disciples are asking for is, please give us enough awareness of you, or awareness of your presence, of the gospel, of your mission, so that we hear that much more loudly than we hear the awful stuff that we're going to be hearing from people who are going to oppress us. And so that we have enough energy from that to respond with love. So that we have the ability to run this marathon when the time comes. We don't have it now, but we're going to need that power, that kind of faith. And that's then where we get the really crucial parable of the mustard seed. Like Jesus tells his disciples, you got the seed of that already within you. And when the time comes, I promise you, like, you're going to be aware of what you need. So that's this idea of faith as preparation. And that really focuses on this idea of developing faith as developing this kind of ability to detect God facts even when things get messy or hard. There's also, and again, if we keep with the exercise metaphor, I think this will help us see how faith functions like a virtue. There's also the way that faith can play a role in our lives after the bad stuff has happened. And in fact, faith can be this really important virtue in dealing with challenges that you were unprepared for or couldn't have anticipated. So I want to think about this for a second. Here's another key fact. You can try as hard as possible to be aware, to be prepared, to have worked really hard on your character, but then still just be one of the unlucky people that gets dealt a really challenging life issue. Maybe it happens to you at a really young age before you've even had an opportunity to prepare yourself to deal with this big happiness challenge. And we know a lot of people who go through this, who not only do they have to deal with serious suffering over the course of their life, but it happens when they're 16 years old or 10 years old. It happens that first year of college, and they never even had a chance to try to become somebody who was ready to run that marathon. Faith can play an important role in understanding that kind of trauma, I think, after the fact. And if we go back with this exercise metaphor, the Greek philosophers use exercise metaphors also all the time when they talk about virtues. If we think about faith as preparation, as like going to the gym and getting your muscles, getting your awareness stronger, doing what the disciples were trying to do, of just trying to pay more attention to noticing God details in the world, we can think about faith as understanding as a kind of rehab. So what to do when you got an injury to your soul, or an injury to your pursuit of the good life, and now you need to try to make a recovery. And this is also something I think that we get guidance from in the Gospels, and it fits in a bit with what philosophers tell us about other virtues. There's my rehab picture. I think St. Paul is a really good person to turn to if you're looking for conceptions of faith that emphasize its rehabilitative function. And so there's another passage. This comes from Ephesians. I wrote down all my notes for this, and of course I didn't print them, and I'm Catholic, so I didn't memorize all the Bible passages the way the rest of you guys probably did. But I think he's writing his letter. No, this is Philippians 4. I know about the Bible. Philippians 4, it's the closing, and St. Paul is, you know, he's been going through struggles, and he knows that the people that he's writing to are concerned for him because he's going through a particularly challenging period in his ministry. And he writes that one of the things he's very grateful for in his gift of faith is that he's been taught to have this awareness of God and this just feeling of love for God in both times of contentment and times when things were going really well and in times of trouble. And he's also taken it seriously that the reason why he's developed this sort of like stable ability to reflect on God is it's given him the resources after the fact to deal with the really troubling experiences. And this is this concept of faith is something that you kind of like, you know, the ability to know how to rehab your bad knee or to know how to rehab your soul when it goes through a period of particular darkness, and to be able to do it, to know how to go about that process of rebuilding. St. Paul is grateful that he got that gift of being able to rebuild after difficulties, and he reflects that here, and he says that he can do all this through God, who gives him that kind of strength. He's helped him develop that ability after the fact to recover. And we see examples, I think quite beautiful examples of this in some people's lives. A story that I think about quite a bit, and I would encourage you guys to go home and go down the YouTube rabbit hole on, is comedian Stephen Colbert. So Stephen Colbert, when he was 10 years old, he's the youngest, I believe, of six or seven children, grew up in South Carolina. When he was 10 years old, his father and two of his older brothers, who he was very close to, Peter and Paul, were on Eastern Airlines Flight 212, September 11th, 1974. They're flying out of the airport in Charlotte, and it was a foggy morning, and because of an avoidable pilot error, the plane crashed, and his father and his brothers were both killed. And Colbert's a very serious Christian, and he talks about it quite a bit on his talk show and in some of his comedy specials, and he gets asked about it a lot because people who, the celebrities he interviews, are like, this is super weird that you got to talk about this so openly. And he'll oftentimes get this question, how on earth do you stay so committed to your Christian identity when this awful thing happened to you as a kid? You know, if we want to press the problem of evil, where was God September 11th, 1974, when this extremely preventable airline accident could have been stopped? You know, pilot makes the right decision, flicks on this one sensor, and then your brother and father live out the rest of their good lives with you, and you get to grow up with a dad. Like, how could you possibly, how could your faith survive something like that? And he talks quite movingly about it, and the way he talks about it, I think, gives us a glimpse of the definition of faith as this kind of rehabilitative understanding in his own life. So I wanted to share a clip. He talks about it quite a bit, but one of the more interesting recent clips, he's talking to Dua Lipa. And they're meant to be talking about, like, her album or something, but she hits him with this curveball of, like, seriously, bro, why are you still so religious? And he gives an answer. So I want to share this, and we'll talk about it.
So I think something that you'll view as really connect with in your comedy and your hosting skills, especially in the past few years, is how open and honest and authentic you are about the role your faith plays in your life. And I was wondering, is there any, you know, does your faith in your comedy ever overlap? And does one ever win out?
I think ultimately, us all being mortal, the faith will win out at the end. But I certainly hope when I get to heaven, Jesus has a sense of humor. But I'll say this. Someone was asking me earlier about this relates to faith, because my faith is involved with, I'm a Christian and a Catholic, and that's always connected to the idea of love and sacrifice being somehow related and giving yourself to other people, and that death is not defeat, if you can see where I'm getting at there. Someone asked me earlier, what movie did I really enjoy this year? And I said, well, I really like Belfast, which is kind of Branagh's story of his childhood. And one of the reasons I love it is that I'm Irish and Irish-American, and it's such an Irish movie, and I think this is also a Catholic thing, because it's funny and it's sad, and it's funny about being sad. In the same way, that sadness is like a little bit of an emotional death, but not a defeat if you can find a way to laugh about it. Because that laughter keeps you from having fear of it. And fear is the thing that keeps you from turning to evil devices to save you from the sadness. As Robert Hayden said, we must not be frightened or cajoled into accepting evil as our deliverance from evil. We must keep struggling to maintain our humanity, though monsters of abstraction threaten and police us. So if there's some relationship between my faith and my comedy, it's that no matter what happens, you are never defeated. You must understand and see this in the light of eternity and find some way to love and laugh with each other.
So obviously, you know, guy's thinking philosophical thoughts quite a bit, but I think he's also illustrative of a way that faith can play a role in somebody's pursuit of the good life. And it's nice because he's a real person. He's not a moral saint. He's not Mother Teresa. He's not a pope or anything. He's a real guy with an actual job who has a lot of good, ordinary things happening in his life, a lot of money. He's very funny. He knows Dua Lipa. So he's not like somebody that's had to make a ton of sacrifices. But he also realizes, much like I'd wish my 8-year-old self would realize, that you can set your goals a little bit higher. Like, you can strive for something in your life beyond just being a Lego master. You can think that there are things that you're going to need in your life going forward besides just fame and money and celebrity, but also this kind of hardiness in your soul to not be dominated by fear, but when really awful things happen, to realize that you can suffer and that that suffering is something other people can empathize with you in, and that you can also laugh, and that you can also have this sense that there's meaning to it that's beyond your understanding in the moment. And, you know, when he was 10 years old and had to process losing his dad and his brothers with his family, this was when he started, if you go back to that mustard seed metaphor, it's when that seed started to grow with him, this idea of, like, over the course of my life, I'm going to have to kind of cultivate this awareness about sadness and love always coming intertwined, and about how fear being is something that moved me away from that, and this awareness that as I strive for better things in my life, I'm going to have to deal with these kinds of feelings as I go along. And that's what faith means to him. So what does it mean kind of practically to try to build this into your life if you're convinced that it's going to be important to having, you know, the Aristotelian idea of a good life in your mind? And here we might start to encounter some objections, and I'm going to wind up so you guys get to ask questions soon. Don't worry. A lot of the ancient philosophers, Plato and Aristotle being key examples, talk about any virtue as being something that we build up over time the same way we change our bodies. And they give a lot of exercise advice, a lot of bad exercise advice in their writings. But, you know, the key example they often talk about is courage. If you want to become a courageous person, you can't just jump right in. That's a reckless idea. So you want to grow in courage. I would not say that you should quit school right now and join the front in the war with the Ukraine, like, and start fighting in a really vicious battle. You're not ready for that kind of courage yet. But you might do simple things to try to make yourself braver. You might do the high ropes course a couple times on campus and start to be a little bit better at dealing with your fear when you're up really high. Or you might try to identify things that are really uncomfortable, like public speaking, and then make yourself do it a lot. Aristotle says we are what we habitually do. You're going to gradually work on changing your soul by doing and increasing levels of difficulty, the activity that's the virtue that you're trying to build in yourself. So can we build faith like a muscle? If you're not a religious person, you might say, well, no. Because it's one thing to try to build up, like, fear resistance, but my definition of faith is, it's, remember, an awareness of God and a loving response. Love is not the kind of thing that you build up like a muscle. And what does it even mean to build up your awareness of God? It's not like awareness of birds where you kind of start seeing them in the trees more closely. Like, how do you even know if you're cultivating an awareness of something like a transcendent God? You might think it doesn't make sense to talk about this kind of faith as being something you can build up incrementally. I'm going to argue against that in my very last slide, but keep thinking about that. Another thing you might think of here is Aristotle talking about caring for your soul. He says a lot of people go to philosophy talks, and they get advice from smart-brained philosophers, and they feel like they've been edified as a result of it, but then they don't change any aspect of how they're living their life. And he's like, they do not have better lives as a result of doing philosophy. They're like people who ask their doctor for treatments and then never do what the doctor prescribes. You might think that faith is something like this. There's lots of, like, motivational sayings that you can buy at Home Goods and frame and put up in your house, but there's not actually a lot that somebody could actually do to start to build up this muscle. And I'd like to push back against that in our last minute here. One more objection you might have, and this will come particularly from religious folks who think about faith in the good life. You might think, faith is not a virtue because it's not the kind of thing you can work up and build in yourself. It's the kind of thing that God gives to you. And he just gives it when he's going to give it. Gives it to St. Paul when he's on his horse one day. Gives it to Augustine in the garden one day. And, like, you get it when you get it, and if you don't have it, you don't have it. Virtues aren't like that. Virtues, you got the little seed within you, and you can kind of work to build it up, or you can let it languish. I think it's perfectly consistent, though I'm happy to argue about this in the Q&A, to think that religious faith is both a gift from God, if you believe in God, but also, much like a Diverge road bike, the kind of gift that you can be more or less ready for when it's given to you. And it can be a bit of a disaster to have something as wonderful as an awareness of God in your life, but not be yet the kind of person who knows how to respond to that awareness in the right way. In fact, it could be devastating. I think we see some people who get that devastating knowledge of God at various points in their life, and then they find that it causes them to have to rethink many aspects of their good life. What does it mean to think about faith as a gift from God, but it's also a virtue that you can work on, and you can work on specifically through philosophical means? And that's where we'll end today. I'm going to give you three good old philosophical tips for building any virtue, including the virtue of faith, and for enjoying your divine road bike. So first tip, and only one of these philosophers is even remotely aware of Christianity. First tip for building up any kind of virtue, including faith, it comes from Plato. And Plato tells us adamantly in the Republic that if you're trying to build a virtue, you should look to the experts and try to imitate them and ideally get them to coach you. So if you want to become more courageous, make sure that the friend who's teaching you how to do the high ropes course is actually a brave person. Otherwise, this could go disastrously wrong. If you're trying to learn how to have faith, then it's going to be helpful to find people who have developed over time practices that seem to cultivate this awareness of God. People who know how to pray, maybe even imitate the prayers that they're using, rather than trying to come up with your own. You might also allow yourself to be coached by experts. And obviously in the Christian tradition, that's the reason why Jesus spent so much time teaching people how to pray. He's kind of coaching people on how to develop this awareness. He's teaching the disciples, yeah, it's going to be hard to do this as you go through in my ministry. That's why I'm going to teach you these prayers so you can kind of start to lean on this and develop an expertise like mine as you go forward. So Plato says turn to the experts. We do have a lot of opportunities for at least people who might be experts in this area of life if it's a muscle that you want to build up. It's telling that Colbert, when he gives his answer to Dua Lipa, he quotes somebody else, a philosopher that he thinks has put this point really movingly, and he's kind of stored that up in his mind as something that he's going to be able to rely on when he needs to answer questions about his own faith. Another thing that's really important, and I don't think we talk about this enough in philosophy of religion or in Christian contexts, Aristotle, in his teachings about the good life, spends a ton of time about friendship and how to understand the different roles that different friends are playing in your life, how to think about your parents as friends or not. He debates this quite seriously with his students. But one of the things he tells us is that our good friends are like our second selves. They're like mirrors that reflect our souls back to us. And a lot of times, the things that we wish for our friends are things that we're struggling to learn how to wish for ourselves in our own pursuit of the good life. So if you want to grow faith as a virtue, Aristotle didn't have this conception of faith as this kind of virtue at all in his lexicon, but his method could easily work in this context. If you're having a hard time thinking, in 2023, I want more awareness of God and more ability to respond to love, stop wishing that for yourself and just think about people who you really care about. Could you wish that they, this year, have more awareness of God and more ability to respond with love? So think about somebody that you know who's going through a hard spell. Could you wish for them that even if you can't take away their suffering, that as they go through it, they're going to be aware that God is with them in it and that they're going to have this grace to respond lovingly to it? Wishing that for other people whom you care about, sometimes Aristotle says it might be a lot easier than even wanting that for ourselves. Wanting my friend to get healthy, wanting my friend to be more courageous, wanting my friend to have this kind of faith is how I might start to care a little bit more about that virtue in my own life and might actually learn how to practice it, especially watching them develop and how their life goes. It's kind of a mirror back to me about what I might hope for in my own life. The third example comes from a philosopher who was very familiar with Christianity. This is William James. He's writing in the late 1800s. He's an American philosopher, writes a lot about faith and the good life. And one of the pieces of advice he has to college students, he gave a lot of speeches to local colleges in the New England area. He was a professor at Harvard. And he would tell college students, don't worry about reasoning it all out right now. If you want to work on developing faith in your life, one, that's a really good idea, because even if you don't become religious, you're going to need faith in a lot of other contexts. And two, just like courage, you're going to build it by looking for the simple opportunities that are presenting themselves in your life right now. So here's an example that James talks about, and we'll wrap up. James thinks that a really important part of the good life, especially when you're a younger person, is love and developing close, intimate relationships. And here's something that's really tricky about love. It often requires a leap of faith moment where you don't know if the person that you love loves you back. You're not certain of it yet. It's not like they've written a treatise or you can be definitely guaranteed that they're reciprocating your feelings. You have to just kind of go for it. In fact, a big part of love is that kind of vulnerability and risk that ties two people together. And James says this is an act of faith that all of us take, regardless of whether we're religious. And what it means is having this kind of like awareness and vulnerability to the other person and this commitment to kind of try it out, to try to respond with love and then see how it works. You might get your heart broken, it could be devastating, but it might be really good. And James says practicing taking those little leaps of like awareness and vulnerability and then love in simple form, simple human relationships might be how we start to build up this muscle so that we have it available to take the bigger leaps when we try to think about something like our love for a transcendent God. Maybe this works, maybe it doesn't. There are lots of problems for James's view as well. There's a whole other version of this talk that's just about William James. But just to say, philosophers do have some very practical advice. What could be more practical than like things you can do with other people this year that can try to change your life in these ways? I think they give us some guidance that maybe we might not find in other quarters. Last bit, and I think that there are some prayers or some passages, at least in the Christian tradition, that capture all of these pieces of advice and try to synthesize them in ways that we can start using right away. And one I think of when we think about these big goals and making sure that our goals are right is a prayer that St. Paul offers in Ephesians. And so I just want to read this, and this will be where they end the talk, and then we'll move to Q&A. But I think he's talking about faith in the sense of like awareness and response in a way that's really beautiful. He says, and he's closing with the Ephesians, he says, I pray that out of all of God's glorious riches, he's going to strengthen you in your pursuit of the good with power through his Spirit in your very inner being, so that Christ can dwell in your hearts through faith, so you can have this kind of awareness that we've been talking about. And I also pray that you be rooted and established in love, that you be able to respond to this awareness with love, and then might have the power together with all of God's holy people, with all of your friends, with all of these other people who are striving for the good life, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. How big that target is that you think you're aiming at in your life. And to know, to become aware that this kind of love surpasses questions of knowledge. That you can be filled to your very measure with all the fullness of God. That can be eudaimonia for you. And to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all that we can ask or imagine, to him that has known for a long time there's more to the good life than just buying as many Legos as possible or buying a new bike, but to him who is immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine in our good life, according to his power that's working within us, to be glory in the church and in Christ throughout all generations forever and ever. Amen. If you think the Bible doesn't have a lot to say about the goals that we set for ourselves and also the capacity to keep raising the bar, I think that's wrong. Like that, this kind of idea that's been inherent in philosophy since even before the Christian tradition became the tradition that we know, it's made fulfilled in these ideas, and they're the kinds of things that can be available just as much for philosophical debate and debate about New Year's goals as they are for Sundays at church. So with that, I have said some interesting, provocative things, I hope, and I hope we can have a little bit of a discussion or at least reactions. And I will turn it over to Rory?
Right.
Riley, who understands how this works.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Can we give another round of applause for Dr. Megan Sullivan? Yes. Okay. So now we are going to transition into our Q&A time of the evening. This will last only around 10 minutes, but how you will do this, you can type in this URL into your phone, or you can send a text, just send your questions, whatever you want to ask Dr. Sullivan. But we are going to get started right here. First question is, what is so unique about a Christian view of the good life?
Oh, that's interesting. It's funny, it's like such a big question that I'm trying not, and we only have 10 minutes, huh? First, there are some dimensions of the Christian view of the good life that are absolutely shareable with non-Christians, and that I think we do ourselves a disservice if we don't think that the kind of philosophical views and ideas of non-Christians are not going to be relevant to thinking about that. So I just did that for you guys today. I started with Aristotle. Aristotle had no idea about Christianity. He was like, unfortunately for him, 350 years too early to really grasp Jesus' life on earth or any of Jesus' teachings. I mean, he knew some things from just reasoning out himself about what was good in a human life, but there was a lot that he didn't have access to. That said, Aristotle's view about us as goal-driven creatures that are aiming for a certain kind of happiness, that are unhappy when we don't understand what we're after, these views become part of how all the people in the Mediterranean world start to think about the meaning of their lives and how they debate it with each other. And when Jesus starts his ministry, and certainly when St. Paul and the Romans get really involved in developing the Christian faith as we know it, they pick this up and they turn it into Christian ethics as we understand it. So the first thing I think it's worth noting about Christianity is how like ununique it is in certain respects, how many resources we have to talk to non-Christians about questions like the good life. What is unique, and we didn't talk about this much at all today, but I think can't be underlined enough, the Christian and Jewish conception of the good life is very much wedded to the greatest commandment. So if we think about what flourishing looks like for humans like us, the answer to that question is to love God with all of our hearts, with all of our minds, with all of our strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves, to love our neighbor selflessly. That mustard seed passage, the disciples are getting a hard message of people are going to be horrible and unjust to you, and you have to love them and immediately forgive them. That's a pretty intense teaching then, and it's a very intense teaching now. I think one thing that is unique about at least the Jewish and Christian tradition that really centers itself in this love commandment is the really unrelenting focus on how important it is to work on this virtue of love to get any of the other virtues. The Greek world, love is important, but it's not like the central virtue the way it is in Christian tradition. And for other visions of the good life or ways of life that philosophy can recommend to us, love will also turn out to be really important. But it's not understood in this selfless, highly sacrificial way that Christians following the model of Christ are really called to spend their time thinking about and to try to conform their life to. And I think that's pretty unique and challenging, the kind of thing we need to do a lot of philosophy to try to understand and grasp.
Yeah, thank you. Next question. How do you think this idea of faith relates to self-accountability while striving for your own eudaimonia?
Eudaimonia.
There you go.
Here's one thing where I think philosophy is really good, if I haven't pitched philosophy hard enough. Forget about just like being happy, which is really hard. One of the wonderful things in life, and Aristotle talks about this quite a bit, is not just being happy, but being able to share and talk about your happiness with other people who you care about. So it can be quite challenging to be having a good life, but to be not sure how to tell your teenage kids about why you think life is so good. Or it can be really hard to like think things are going really well at work, but to not have a kind of language in your office for talking about why things are going so well. One thing philosophy is really good about is taking things that we kind of know but don't have an ability to express, and then kind of figuring out what those reasons are so that we can share them with people that we love. Aristotle says in, I think, book 9 of the Nicomachean Ethics, he says, perceiving that you're happy is a good thing. It's a good thing to think, like, I'm having a good day. But it's even better to perceive that your loved ones are happy. And one of the things that's really remarkable about being human is that we can not only keep track of our own inner lives and how things are going for us, but we can also be aware of our friends' lives. And the way that we become aware of that, Aristotle says, is through conversations, through our ability to talk about it. You're driving your kid to school, and you have that 20-minute conversation in the car that gets surprisingly deep, and you really get a glimpse of what's going on in their life at the moment. And that can be where the real joy of being a parent is, or like a real friendship, you have this like long, surprising conversation. And I think that one thing philosophy is really good about is helping us, if we're doing philosophy in our minds and practicing these philosophical skills about talking about the good life, talking about faith, when the time comes that you need to share what's inside of you with the people that you love, philosophy is going to give you the skill to do that.
Yeah, that's good. So this will be the last one. How does eudaimonia apply to those who lost hope in seeking a good life, let alone a future?
Yeah, well, despair is not part of eudaimonia, at least in the Greek conception. So when you're experiencing despair, you're experiencing this kind of absence of the thing that you think you're really aiming for, which is to be a human that's satisfied and that's fulfilled. But it's also, and we all know if you live long enough or you live through the times that we've lived through, that it's also just part and parcel of the lives that we actually have to navigate. I love that Colbert clip for a lot of reasons, but one of the key things I'd point out to you, and I'd ask you to look at other interviews where he talks about either his faith or he talks, you know, there's a really great Anderson Cooper interview where he talks specifically about remembering losing his dad, whom he loved. And one of the things I think is really beautiful about this is somebody who thinks he wishes that some of the most awful events in his life had never happened. Like, he clearly wishes his father and brothers had never died. But he also feels extraordinary gratitude for his whole life and all of the good things that's happened before and after that awful event. And he also realizes that keeping his whole life in mind and trying to make himself into the kind of person that's able to understand what's really beautiful and meaningful about that life means grappling with fitting the horror into that story. And he tries to remind us, like, this is also one of the essence of Christian teaching. I mean, one of the most mysterious things about Christianity, there's so many mysterious, philosophically confusing things about Christianity, but one of the most mysterious things is to achieve a good life now and in eternity, you have to spend a lot of time thinking about how a person died and was tortured. And how does, like, going into that suffering, St. Paul says, like, dying with Christ, help us somehow get the resources to have a good, for us to have a good life, us who aren't present in that time? And I think that's, you know, there are simple answers for this. If you think the good life is going to be given to you by, like, an app or a sleep hack or a new diet, one of the really awesome messages of Christianity is realizing that that is weak sauce for some of the kinds of problems that are coming our way. And in fact, this ability to practice over time and as a community and with God's help to grapple with, like, what the most significant forms of human suffering and injustice are is also what's going to build us up into the kind of people who are able to appreciate the real meaning of the great things in our life.
Thank you. Okay, so that wraps up our event for tonight. Can we give her another round of applause?
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. And yes, before you go, we have the books. We have her book in the back. The shipyard is selling that. And if you have any more questions, you can come.